Welcome back, my dearest friends. Welcome back to ever so amazing turn-based chronicles, where I am playing certain beautiful, amazing turn-based strategy games specifically out there. And at this time we're playing one mission, one purpose, under one flag, which is not Cain Lives Forever. Now, the point is, we're playing the amazing game called Age of Wonders 3, and Age of Wonders 3 alone. No DLCs, nothing amazing like that at the moment. So no expansion packs, sorry, expansion packs, not DLCs, expansion packs for it at the moment. But at some point there shall be also those, and we'll be able to show off some beautiful halflings, tigrins, beautiful frostlings, or even the undead fuckers. But mostly we'll be ever playing, well, that is, fighting against those than ever playing, because I'm not I don't like playing as an evil race in or faction in usually in games. I just prefer the good guys, so to speak, but hell's bells. Anywho, so we're continuing on with Conan Lion of Aquilonia, no less, of course, the King Conan, the Kingenzy of all kings. And we had one battle in the Temple of Glory, and we gotten a Stick of Truth, an epic item of sorts. Let's see exactly what Conan gained. I think it's a stick of some sort. Yes, a lizard on a stick. Not just a stick, it's a lizard on a stick. It's an epic usable item. It's a poison spit. Spits poison at target enemy unit, which is good because now we'll have an additional power-up, well, an additional ability as Conan, alongside, of course, the heavy crossbow, which is always nice. So at the moment, he is still level 1. As you can see exactly what he is, what... that is what the thing is, his warlord class, that's exactly it. The moment my mind is all over the place, I'm playing too many beautiful, sexy, amazing games, and I have no idea where I am most of the time. Sorry about that, but not really, who cares. Moving on, so he's a human warlord, level 1. We need a little bit more of XP, actually, quite a bit, because this was like one battle against a ogre and two baby spiderlings of evil. He is neutral at the moment, but we are going for the good guy thingy, because that's how I like to play. So hell's bells. So this is our big army. We lost one of the long swordsmen, sadly, in a previous combat, our only, but again, we do have a priest here, one priest, and one human civic guard, which I will not be utilizing whatsoever, unless I'm really low on money. But in all honesty, I would definitely go with a human priest, if anything, hell's bells. So he's gonna be joining this group now. Thank you very much. Okay, beautiful. Okay, so you can see here, Army of Conan, 16 movement point out of 36. Understandable, right? As you can see, exactly see everybody moved, and we did not yet end the turn. We just went to the first combat situation. We're gonna be continuing moving over here. We can talk a little bit more about stuff that you actually collect on the map, and that's specifically mana nodes. You have beautiful mines, you have farms, each thing give you different stuff. You have this magma thingy, which is at the moment under the independent control, but magma forge, explored treasure site, adds plus 10 production when located within your domain, for instance. So we, at the moment, we have a mana node. If you upgrade the mana node on a specific thing that is your class that you've chosen, as a, for instance, if you went with the water thingy, elemental, a fire elemental thingy that is your specific, I don't know exactly what we are at the moment, at least. What is Conan? What truly he is. Oh man, I totally forgot where the... Oh yeah, there you are. Okay, so we are actually a creation. So we can actually exchange the regular mana nodes into the creation, fire, water, air, whatever node. It gives you additional income. Not just plus 10 mana, plus 10 something else. In that, how you actually change these nodes, usually you have the casting of the spells on a global scale, and actually get stuff. So this is the global spells at the moment we can cast. And I don't know if that usually it's kind of a maybe different, I have no clue. I only played a little bit as a Dreadnought class in the campaign as a Commonwealth. You have the fire node thing, so you can exchange the mana node for the fire node, and it adds quite a bit more of a boost to things to come. So that's, of course, a nice thing. I like that. I mean, that's all in all other Age of Wonders games did not change, they didn't dumb down anything that was important, mind you, nothing important. They have, like, they changed kind of for the sieging, how it works, specifically sieging of the towns. You have three gates to conquer instead of occupying, well, surrounding the town with all of your armies like in previous games. Well, dependable, to be honest, because if you have the massive, if you're fighting against like a massive town in Age of Wonders 1, like the really uppity town, best town possible, you usually have like 3 points of attack compared to actually surrounding the entire town if you're sieging a village, if you're sieging a small town or something like that. But in this one, it's always sieging one, like in Heroes of Might and Magic, you're sieging specific gate, but in this case you have three gates, when you attack outposts, which are not towns, you can actually attack them from all the sides. So they did keep that aspect still of Age of Wonders 1 and 2, where you can actually surround these outposts completely from all 6 sides. But when it comes to regular sieging, it's always up front. It doesn't matter where you position, from which side you're attacking and supporting the main attack with the additional forces. So there is that. I was actually kind of really angry about it before the game came out, but I understand the point as to why they did it now. So it's all good for Daemon. Okay, so at the moment on a global scale, what we really have is Authority of the Sword, strategic spell, city enchantment. So this is a city enchantment, forces neighboring lands to submit to the Empire's rule through demonstration of military power. Target Flanders City gains a +1 domain radius. And of course, that tells you the cost, the casting points and all that. But of course, we don't have enough casting points, not enough mana. I mean, we have maximum 20 casting points, so not, we won't be able to even utilize this spell. But it does, you have 10 per turn how much it costs. So you have to always waste 10 mana per turn every turn since moment you cast the Authority of the Sword. Plus 40 disjunction cost, have the fucking clue what that freaking means, but there you go. Maybe you can tell me exactly what disjunction is. You can actually again find everything here to tell you. We will not look through the entire Tome of Wonders because it's wonderful. But we shall move on to see other stuff like Seek Inspiration, strategic spell, instant spell, creates the skill book and causes new skill to appear for your research. If you're not happy with what you gain in the research tab, you know, like, these spells don't work for me, you just go with that and you get a little bit refreshing. It's always, and usually most spells are always random what you get at the start. So it's very interesting. Again, I like that randomness, I really enjoy it very much so. So that's again a beautiful thing in Age of Wonders 3, though again in Age of Wonders 2 I think it's the same thing, but the heroes worked quite differently, as of course in Age of Wonders 1 the same thing. In this game you have classes, in previous game you did not have classes, they were always mixed between wizard and a warrior, though to be honest in Age of Wonders 2 it's specifically a wizard. You're a wizard, Harry, and you're always gonna be a wizard. So there is that in Age of Wonders 2 and Shadow Magic. While you actually collect heroes, like we got this orc hero that we just gotten, Brianka, Banka, Wenka, whatever her name, I'll have to remember it at some point, but at the moment I don't care for it. But yeah, in this one specifically, now your hero is a hero like in Age of Wonders 1. So it's definitely a little bit of a mix between Age of Wonders 1 and Age of Wonders 2, so that's great, of course, beautiful stuff. Inspire Loyalty, as you can see the costs are massive, like 100 mana and 5 casting points. I mean, 100 mana, it's a lot of mana that we at the moment do not have. So this is a strategic spell world enchantment, right? So we have a city enchantment, here we have an instant spell, and we have a world enchantment. The caster and their empire's heroes gain Inspire Loyalty. All units in the army of a hero that has Inspire Loyalty gain Volunteer. Units with Volunteer require -50% upkeep. That's actually quite amazing, but 20 per turn, 5 turns to actually cast this, right? Yes, 5 turns to actually cast this damnable thing to be able, like, holy crap. It's a class Warlord tier 3, of course, does tell you here your beautiful number, exactly tell you everything. I also like that they didn't go Metro look about their interface, which is very important to me, as I do not like games with a Metro look. Like, the perfect example, Skyrim, that Metro ugly disgusting look of of the UI. I like when it has a personality, I like when it has a soul, I like when it has actual kind of a, like, thought put into it. If you ever played Age of Wonders 1, you remember when you go into the main, in the game, you go into the options menu, or that is the menu, and you have this dragon holding the crystal ball of some, or not ball actually, he's just dropping the beautiful rays of light on what you choose, and he's happier or sad. You know, like that when you move onto the exit or the options are close to him, he's like, he makes certain faces. And I like that. That's, again, this is little details that really look beautiful. Like, Heroes of Might and Magic 4, of all the Heroes games, looks the most prettiest in terms of UI. Like, the mostly, like, the UI looks amazing. Very detailed. You can see that someone put a lot of work into it. And that's very important. It's not cheap, shitty stuff. So, okay, so this is what we have. We not can't do anything. We have 30 mana, plus 23, and plus 46 of research at the moment. We are going 4. Minus 6 on gold, because no production of anything, I guess, or too many units at the moment. As we can over here, we see minus 7 to upkeep, minus 6 to gold income. Again, we're getting for a base in the city, plus 39, plus 25. We are actually producing merchandise, but you have to wait a little bit one turn to get plus 13 here. But still, we're gonna be capturing this area. As you can see, here is a gold mine, additional gold mine, gonna give you plus 10 gold. It's unexplored, it's under the control of the lizards, draconians, sorry, not the lizard faction, the draconian faction. The lizard faction is non-existent. In the Age of Wonders 1, there were like, I don't know, 15 faction or 12, I think 15, 16 faction, something like that, I think, let me think. I don't know, I think actually 12 factions. God damn it, there are a lot of factions, but the Shadow Magic had a huge chunk ton of factions in the end. So, like in this one, we have Draconians. Draconians were in Age of Wonders 2, not in, I don't think in Age of Wonders 1, there were the Lizard Folk. But I can't really remember, there are so many factions, ridiculous. Like, you know, usually in games you never gain this huge chunk of factions, races, from the get-go. And that's a very, I mean, like, it's a very interesting thing, considering, you know, that, you know, how much the gaming community went further away from gameplay and the actual game, and more into the graphic standpoint of the game. Nonetheless, the game looks amazing here in this case. When you zoom out, you have this beautiful overview, which I really adore the look of it. It looks different for each kind of a setup. If it's a winter party, if it's actually the summer part, if it's actually that is the lush forest areas, if it's actually the dead part, that is the undead land, it all has its own look when you look from the distance like this. And I really like it. It's like that you see in Lord of the Rings and something like that. That is a beautiful little thing. And of course, it tells you exactly, you have a teleporter here, you can see the your own stashes of gold, of course, alongside your armies, in on their own flags. You can see the actual throne of Somakar and of Koanver for us, and of course our entire a beautiful borderline of what we are actually owning here. So at the moment we cannot pick up this beautiful stash of gold, which is always needed, but it's only minus 6, so it's not, oh my god, demon, it's a GG. No, it's not, not yet. We shall go on to this mana thing, pick up 68 mana, never a bad thing, we're at least going good on mana. So what did I say? I wanted to go immediately onto the storehouse so I can get the beautiful plus 100 pop and increase as fast as possible the spread of my love here. But considering that I have two settlers, I can do whatever I really want in the end of a day here. So we can make a city right here that it will occupy two gold mines here and one mana node, which is gonna be amazing. That's gonna be a big, big boost for me. Specifically, but of course my ally might even try that, to be honest. The considering that his home city of the dwarven home city, the main capital city, is very close, he will still need a lot of time to expand towards this, so definitely I'm going for it. He also has his own beautiful settlers. We all, I'm guessing, starting in the same fashion, get a hero, additional hero, gain bunch of sexy units. The dwarven units are here, of course, and we can't do much anymore except go into this forested area and wait out. Now, these are not movable independent units, they do not move all around, but there are brigand camps and they might spawn brigand units and stuff like that all over the place. They will, or you know, something like that, at least I think they will. Though, to be honest, when you do defeat a faction in the previous Age of Wonders games, they tend to still be there and just go independent and then just roam over the lands and actually do some pretty much bad stuff on your ass. So here we have Lizardmen, which will be attacking immediately in the next turn. They have a Draconian Hatchling, we have a Draconian Flame at tier 1, and of course we have the also additional 3-1 Draconian Crusher. I was actually expecting the level tier 2. But there you go, likes Barons, of course likes Barons and like Baron. He enjoys Baron grounds, he likes Barons. There you go, beautiful, and of course the where he's standing, that's where he likes, it's Baron terrain, which is of course nice for them, I guess, maybe bad for us, who knows. Anywho, let's see these beautiful things. So these are the next enemy we'll be fighting. Again, I like the design, the Draconians are mostly Azteki Mayan kind of inspired design. For instance, Frostlings are more inspired in terms of Santa Claus, and because you have Dire Penguins for the win. I love those Dire Penguins. And let me see, who else? Oh yes, the Tigrans are completely Egyptian faction. Oh, derp, of course. But they look amazing. I love the look of their guardsmen, like just ridiculous. And of course, their Draconians look amazing here. Projectile resist stones overwhelming, which is the same thing that our swordsmen, I think, have. Overwhelm does 3 damage against pikemen and shielded units. Projectile resist against additional 2 defense against ranged attacks. Very sexy for them, of course. Improved wall climbing. This unit, this is improved, not just wall climb, but improved wall climb. This unit is able to climb city walls. Unlike normal wall climbing, the unit suffers no penalty while stood on wall hexes. Which is the thing is, like, if you're wall climbing, they drop the ladders and they go on ladders, right? And the thing is, there's so much, that's a critical moment for them, because they can get so much damage done to them by the enemy that you can lose immediately the entire stack of units, well, specifically the entire group of that unit. So this is much better for them, because they do not suffer any penalties in terms of that. So there is that for them, good stuff for them. Of course, they introduce the Draconian, which are, of course, Draconians recover from their wounds more quickly than other races and are resistant to fire while being more vulnerable to the cold. Most Draconian spellcasters have the ability to hurl fire at the enemies. As of course you can see, I mean, they're just telling what the is a race they are. Like Barons and Lava, dislikes Arctic, hate Blighted. There's nobody likes Blighted terrain except Goblins. Goblins actually thrive on it and actually even heal upon it, if I'm not mistaken. And of course bonuses and all that, fast healing, and that's good stuff. Of course, they have fast healing, as you can see, of course, Frost Weakness and Fire Protection. Not a huge chunk of Fire Protection, considering they are the Draconians, but only 20%, I guess 20% is amazing, but else well. And let's see, 46 health points is a basic warrior unit, I guess, if you will. It's a tier 1 recruit, of course, but 46, unbelievable amount of points of health, I guess. 28 normal movement, 9 defense, and 8 resistance. Actually, quite lower than the human swordsman, if I'm not mistaken. Quite lower on defense points here. And even lower than the halberdiers, the human halberdiers, I think. But hell's bells. Okay, we have the Draconian Flamer. Look at these bad boys. Look at them. They like just want to flame someone's ass. Fire bomb. So they do regular melee 5 damage and 2 fire damage. If they use the fire bomb, they 4 and 7. Launches a volley of fire explosions at the target unit. The fire deals splash damage to units in 1 hex ray round. So they are, of course, the AoE, of course. Understandable. It's a range medium, no line of sight penalties, no long range damage penalty, cannot be used while in, okay, like, they're, well, like, it's much better, but how close that do they need to really be to drop that thing? They have lava walking, of course, we, of course, understandable, which is great. I like that. I mean, they fucking have fire bombs, they utilize fire like nobody's bitch. 7 defense and regular defense and 8 against magic, 34 health points and 28 movement, which is again, it seems that standard for every infantry unit. There, of course, everything else is normal. Now, here comes Draconian Hatchlings, which are the unique unit in their own right. They're small little bastards, ugly little bastards, that cute little bastards indeed. Fire spit 11 fire damage they do. Straight shot, I mean, 75% line of sight penalty if a straight shot and all that. Evolving, so when this unit reaches gold medal rank, it evolves into. So these are some random, whatever. So these are the options to what you might get out of them. So you get a Draconian Crusher, Draconian Charger, Draconian Flamer, Elder, or a Flyer. Okay. So it would just involve and maybe just chooses out of all those. So it's awesome because Draconian Elder, all that, like the Flyer, are very dangerous units in general. So hell's bells. So this is gonna be our next attack, well, that is the group we will be attacking. Then after that we'll be attacking against the summoned units, and specifically the Wisp and the Phantasm Warrior. And this gold mine is actually for the taking. I can immediately drop the town here, and the moment we defeat these, we actually gain a flag over them. So that just when we need, well, of course, we need to just defeat them, and that's the gist of it. Excellent. See, it tells you exactly what it will encompass and what it will take from it. And that's exactly what we want. It tells us exactly what we'll be getting out of all that beautiful stuff. And that's exactly what Demon wants. I'm going to drop it right here. Our new town or whatever name. We can randomize. We can choose our names. You can rename all the cities you want. So that's great, of course, if you're willing. I like that addition in any game. So Fastburg is going to be our next city. Beautiful, and there you go, it's slowly making it thing known. And the next time we'll be attacking these. Okay, what should we do with the Civic Guard? You know, honestly, we can try and maybe explore, because I feel there might be something in this darkish area, in this fog of war. Let's go over here with the Civic Guard. Move in. Okay, so here we go, an army, a kind of independent army, and of course bunch of scoundrels. And what I like about this game is that each faction can actually have unique armors, so to speak, can be a scoundrel, for instance, but they all look different. Like, this is a Draconian scoundrel, right? Then you have high elf scoundrels, then you have dwarven scoundrels, and they all have, like, they are scoundrels, but they all have their own models. That's what I really, really love. If you play as a Dreadnought class, you have the ability to have the musketeers, the armored musketeers, the flame tanks, all the good stuff the Dreadnought class is really. Yeah, really awesome looking fucking thing, right? But then you have the high elf musketeers, and then you have like high elf, and they're much like different looking model, well, just more tight around the waist than the human models would be, or the dwarven musketeer or something like that. But again, they put enough, like, lizard, that is Draconians, always the lizard. Draconians have their tail behind, even though like they have armored model, but they have just a tail addition because they're lizard class. And I like that because it just shows you how much work they put into that. Each model of the same class, or a different class, has a different model to the same class of a same model, which is the class of awesome. So there you go. So again, I like that addition. I like that they put enough work to just, you know, for each faction, for each race, to have their own thing. And it's a lot of work when you think about it, but I love that they put that work into the action. So again, let's see, do they all have the same thing? Well, not really, except the, like, as again, these are the high elves. They are a little bit stuff beyond that, but they all can actually inflict crippling wounds. So melee and range attack can cause the target to be crippled. Crippled units lose minus 12 movement points for 2 turns, which is not really bad considering, you know, like, that's not bad when you have a big army. These scoundrels are nothing to be afraid. 35 health points here, 28, 10, 8. And of course, 8-8, it would seem, of course, dwarves are much more sturdier bastards. That's why they gain quite a bit more of resistance, defense 10 and 9, compared to 8 and 8. So Draconian 8, sorry, the Elven actually has by one better resistance, and there you go. Elves are sexy beasts. Honestly, they, in Age of Wonders, I adore the look of the elves. I adore all the elves, but I usually avoid elves and stick to the humans for some sort. But in Age of Wonders, all races look amazing, and especially Age of Wonders 2. The sprite work in Age of Wonders 2 and Shadow Magic is mind-blowing. So there is that. Now, of course, there are other things that I really want to talk about, but for now we can end the turn here, as we have done everything that we could. We got a peace treaty with these bastards, which is great, and as soon as we can get them under our control, even as a vassal state, the Mirror City is going to get destroyed probably, and I hope that's actually the truth, because if not, we're fucked.
Oh, a little bit of gold here. We shall not allow our dwarven friends to get that gold. And thank you very much. Also, I do like the addition as to when how your cities are being bigger and bigger, and you can actually see the farms all around the cities that is beyond the city gates. I like that. Just such a sexy little details. That's what I'm always for when it comes to 3D games. I mean, here they're utilizing 2D animated trees to just give you a sense of epicness, of big, and they look beautiful. Look at how charming these trees look, actually. Again, those are little things that matter to me the most when the developer knows how to mix 2D and 3D properly. That's a big plus for me. Like in Cossack 3, just beautiful mix between 2D, or should I say representation, all from the 2D of the original Cossack game into a 3D engine. It looks perfect, like nothing changed visually, that you're always familiar with it. I'm gonna talk about a lot of things, because this entire series is an introduction to what is gonna become even bigger series down the line for me. I mean, we have to cover the campaigns, we have to cover the sexual innuendos, like demon is sexy and you know it, but that's not innuendo because it's a fact, right? I have big wings, but you know it. Anyway, so is that really, we can move this one, but there is no point, in all honesty. Like, there is nothing I can do at the moment with this settler, as there is, like, if I'm getting this, maybe here. Actually, I'm gonna move this settler. I'm gonna move him and make additional city here, but again, to gain proper stuff like this mine, we still have to destroy these bats, which are the elves, the high elf union guards, and of course high elf initiate. I believe initiate can actually level up to high elf sisters of power battle, so that's sexy. So that's it, my friends. We have our research at the moment. Warfare number one, so increase our casting points to plus 10. And it gives us a more mana capacity to hell, and instead of 500, we're gonna be having 600. We cannot cast anything, so it's a GG, and game tells you demon, end the turn. Let's end the turn. So now we are waiting, Baradir, and all the beautiful is in the bottom. You can actually see who is now doing it, thank you. Baradir has won the battle, of course, against the independents. And there you go. We have our city, and you can see the control lines and all the good stuff. We are yet to have this beautiful thing that will give us plus 10 knowledge under our, if when we get it under our control. So Baradir has won the Battle of Glory. We can actually look at that battle by pressing replay button. And you can, and I like that. I like that. You can actually now go and see what kind of how the dwarves well against the wisps. They are fake creature of evil, but in general they are nothing to really, with 16 health points, I mean GG. But it also depends, well, sometimes they are guarding specific spots that have, like we had when we fought it on the temple grounds, on the ruined temple grounds, we had the curse ability on us all. So that was a bad no thing. So some things like mana nodes can be defended, like these bastards, they might, from that mana node, they might gain something of a curse or a buff for the defenders, which was gonna be very tough to fight against. So that, thankfully we have that blast spell, and I'm very happy about it. So we're now back to 30 casting points. We have enough mana to cast when we fight the draconians, which we'll be doing immediately now, my dearest friends. And of course warfare one researched, thank you very much. Let's go on to select a new upgrade. We have additional, we have off the beaten path, interesting. That's a level 2 spell, Empire upgrade, that means it's a default, it's a passive upgrade. Irregular units receive mountaineering, forestry, and wetlands walking, which of course is always a good thing to have on irregular units like civic guards, so they can go through everything without any penalty. But that's three turns that I really don't care. So let's see, lion's courage I would like. Ooh, fertility rights. Ooh, the population of your entire empire grows 15% faster. As a necromancer, the undead population of your empire grows 15, but it's the same thing, so just, you know. But it definitely, the fertility is for the undead also. We're gonna go for that one. It's only two turns and 90 knowledge. I like that. Death March, Terraformer, which is one of the most unique thing about Age of Wonders series, is the terraforming. Terraforming is a big thing because each faction likes something, right? What kind of a terrain they dwell upon the best. And sometimes you can freeze water so you can walk across it, or you can maybe, I don't know if you can melt ice, but I know in, for instance, in Age of Wonders 2 you can summon mountains on the areas there were never mountains. Like on, if there's a road and you utilize spell summon mountains, you just get mountains on top of the road, and you can go across the mountains, but it's gonna, without mountaineering, it's gonna take a huge chunk of your movement points, and that way close off enemy possible army from getting to reaching your city before you reach your own city, if it's for instance. Yeah, but in general I like those things that the Age of Wonders does compared to any other game out there. It just does such interaction with the world you're on that you do care for on what you're playing on, what terrain you're playing on, and what race you're leading with. So at the moment I'm going for Trinity Rise because that's exactly what I want, expanding more and better, because we do have the expander with beautiful Conan here, which will give us what exactly? Expander again, farms and springs of light generate an additional 50 population growth. Corrupted farms, of course, but yeah, for farms and springs of life. At the moment, we do not have springs of life. We have not even found a farm, so to speak. I think at least not in the, and there it is, that's a farm. So great farm adds plus 100 pop when located within your domain. We have a little bit of pigs and a little bit of sheep, but only sheep because there are no pigs here. There you go, excellent. Again, graphically the game looks amazing. 10 out of 10 from Demon, thank you very much. So finally we can pick up this gold that I always wanted to pick up. And we have so many civic guards, so these are irregulars. So if we gotten that beautiful irregular stuff, we would be able to cross the beautiful forested areas without any penalty. You see, 6 compared to 3 movement, 3 movement, base movement point, 6 inside the dense vegetation. Okay, so let's take finally the watchtower, which is much needed. Okay, it was being captured, and there you go. And this is what it really reveals upon our. Okay, so there you go. We have a frost wyvern, we have a bunch of baby reed serpents, and nothing to really be afraid of. But a good position to build additional city right here. Right, like, in the center, like, maybe here. We could do that, but again, the point is, until we clear everything out of the enemies, unless they've been being clear, for instance, we will be gaining this gold mine. That's a nice thing to gain. We could do that immediately, like, drop it right here, right there, and we'll be able to gain that gold mine. We'll not get a magma forge. We can move here, thank you very much. Yes, Langton, I'm gonna go that immediately. We'll expand slowly. I hope these bastards do not take, but they're actually guarding something very valuable. Scrolls of knowledge. A boost of knowledge to current 3. So we are on 2 here. We're going to get immediately more knowledge and we can finish it much quicker. Oh, quicker. Quicker. Yeah, that's how we're going to be doing it. In general, you can just research faster. And that's always a good thing to find. Okay, so that's done. Let's move on with the regulars. Actually, I'm going to split the regulars. We're going to go into the teleporter, and I'll see where the teleporter actually leads us. This could be very scary. Oh, Gamarak! Before us lies Gamarak, twin city of Karamak. Of course. And of, it's quite on our side, of course. If we could get some kind of a, hey, hello, we need to support each other. We need to support each other. Village of Kithrin. Now the thing is the Kithrin something we discovered before, or is this specifically we've discovered? Okay. We saw the second village. So there is additional village here. I don't think that's the village because it doesn't have the beautiful goblet from which Jesus drank. Not really. I don't think I will have to worry about them, but we can get some kind of possible alliance. But I'm gonna go with these bastards. Immediately. Hello? Oh, they're goblins. Ooh, this could be a problem. Negotiate. Well, let us open the borders. Again, alignment, all the good stuff. Not that we can really do much anyway, so let's get the peace treaty with the goblins and hope for the best, unless our friend, unless the enemy takes their own mirror city or some other mirror city, this mirror city to this mirror city, that would be a kind of a problematic thing indeed. Which is this one. So if the enemy takes this one before we can take this one, it's a pretty much a GG. But again, I'm going through the peace thing. It doesn't really matter because at the end, it's to defeat all the enemies on the map, mind ya. So this is all about who has more towns and more developed towns. As I said, if we gain these towns specifically, it's a it's probably better. I mean, he probably has more upgrades inside, maybe not. We'll see how that's gonna really work for us. So, okay, thank you very much. Yes, thank you, Capture Gamorak, of course. You meet the village of Kitherin, which is always nice, of course. Let us open. And you do not have enough gold, Master. We have 66, so we cannot really get into the talk with the Draconians, which is okay. Here, we cannot even do anything against these. There are three of them, one of us, and just nothing we can do about it. I would like this beautiful thing, which is called the gold. And I could do that immediately. Let me do it. Well, not immediately, in the next turn. Go over the mountain. It's gonna cost 14 movement points to go over the mountain. Hex. It's ridiculous, but understandable. Even if we did DW the regulars, they do not get specific mountaineering. That's to the dwarves. That's the dwarf thing. Specifically. Okay, so I'm gonna continue on with these irregulars and explore the Lands of Glory. The Lands of Age of Wonders. Thank you very much. Lake production in Fosburg. So Fosburg is again a small outpost at the moment. If you want to upgrade, you need to upgrade specifically something that will give you population on it. So we're going to go plus 100 additional population, 12 turns. You need 3,000. Well, with 100, I mean, better anything than nothing, right? Better than anything than nothing, I would say. Again, where are those damnable housings? Build housing. Increase the base population growth by 50%. Okay, there you go. Well, we can do that immediately, actually. Thank you. Excellent. It doesn't cost anything except taking away a few of your turns to do so. So there is that. Here we are building, of course, the storehouse, which will go to the public bath to give us the ability to heal our own units around our city and stuff like that, or while we are inside the city. The good stuff is all there, mind you. There are so many options in the game, it's ridiculous. You ain't gonna find anything like this anywhere else. Because it's micro, it's macro, it's demon, it's sexy, it's everything. There's so much choices, so many choices, but it's also very much personal. This is not a civilization game, per se. Like, it's definitely not. I mean, this is supposed to, the Age of Wonders was supposed to be a Masters of Magic inspired game. So, it's more akin to Masters of Magic. And I probably think many people never played it, like me. I never played Masters of Magic. I watched other people play it. So I do understand where is the connection there. But it's definitely not a civilization game. It doesn't work like that, thankfully, because in civilization games, I never can connect to my people. But in this one, I can connect to one hero I make and what units I make, and my units who are actually leveling up slowly but surely. And they are there with your hero, and it's amazing, and it's just sexy like a beast. So final battle, where we're gonna be again ending the video after we take this gold mine. Thank you very much. Excellent. So let's see again, very likely a victory. We can do auto combat. I never go with auto combat because you lose the focus on how to utilize units properly. So this is what we're gonna be doing it. So go into the manual again and fight the good fight against the Germans. If the Germans win, Germans win. If Germans lose, they lose. Fuck them. But that's okay. And there you go. So a little bit of a different battleground this time around. We're fighting for the mines, the gold mines, so that of course we're fighting on the parts where they gather gold. So the Pens are moving. This time again they choose to defend, which is very interesting compared, as I said, to most. Sometimes they tend to just charge into your ranks and just say, hey, we want to kill you first if we can. So up front we have the Halberdiers. Do remember, they have actually been leveled up, as you can see. They are actual troopers now, not veteran troopers. They get 1 melee strength and 2 hit points. Not a huge chunk of anything, to be honest. So we have Draconian Crusher, has a 46, beautiful stuff indeed, 12 damage. We have 12 damage and 47. That's actually quite a bit indeed. 28, 28, 10, 11, 10, 10, 8. There you go. So a little bit better just by one under Coney Crash in terms of defense. These bats we can easily kill. 33 health points. But again, 11 defense and 10 on Magic. 9, 10. Still, they will pose a bit of a problem. So that's great. Okay. Because I don't like anything easy, Manja. But easy, it's not always good. So let's move our first and foremost. Now we have ability to poison spit. Always beneficial, I would say. Where are my archers? Archers up front. Over here. Go. Beautiful. You need a rank. You definitely need a rank on the archers. And I do like that now I have two priests, which will definitely support our units as we attack them. Not gonna utilize them immediately, because they also heal that first 15 health points. Plus the additional one armor protection on resistance to certain things. Which are... what exactly? Let us see the heart. Okay, yeah, just resistance, magic resistance, normal resistance, and heals the target unit. I want to try and attack them from the side. Minutes is my cav, if it's a cav after all. Let's see what I can utilize with you. I'm going to block them over here if they try to attack, because I'm going to try to murder them with these taunts. Not like that. That's not what I wanted to go. Yeah, again, the range... the range is for this is going to like take a little bit. So I'm going to definitely move up here with Conan. No range for any of these things, definitely. You can see the maximum range, the minimum range. And definitely won't be able to be touched upon anything there. So, archers there, thank you very much. Let's move you behind Conan, because I like you. I want you to protect Conan. I don't want Conan to get fucked, butt fucked by the enemy. Actually, go to the side here, because that's a good side. Turn towards the enemy, towards the enemy, thank you very much. And of course, they do have their own spirit raised. Shoots a spirit ray to target enemy by 8 Demarche, which is always a good thing. Okay, so I guess everybody on Conan. Why the hell not? Go around the Conan. He's our king, for fuck's sake. Protect the king. Protect the king. Okay. You can go immediate defense. By default, when you move on to the... when you end the turn, you immediately get defense bonus, I think, anyway. But it does go into defensive side, raising a defense, and that is normal defense, and the defense in terms of magic. So there you go. If you press immediately, so 10, 8. If you press again, now 12 and 10 the protection against Demarche. So there is that. Okay, so that's it, my friends. We're gonna try and go from with our light cav to the sides, onto the hatchlings, and do the good fight against those bastards. Okay, so let's end our turn and see how this is gonna go. We have a blast, and we have additional, I think. Okay, they're definitely not moving against us. So let's see, Holy Cure, and we have blast. What again is the blast? A blast units have plus 2, okay, with additional armor, plus 300, okay, well, that's actually never a bad thing, to be honest. I mean, the healer would like to keep that 10 casting and 10 mana. Tenko, we did get that research, which gives additional 10 casting points, so from time we have 30 casting points, so that's always a good. And considering that blast actually just costs 5 casting points and 5 mana, it's always a good thing. So I'm gonna go first on my halberdiers. Always, do you get that additional protection when they are not in a defensive stance? Let us see how close they can get. Okay, we have a lot of room to maneuver with these fuckers. Like, a lot of room to maneuver. Go. Excellent. Yeah, out of range still. But maybe we'll be able to lure them, and that is an important thing. And then run away a little bit. You know, lure and run away if need be. Okay, move in a little bit. Again, let's see. Yeah, definitely they won't be able to attack us. That's their last, and even if they do, they will be able to do one damage and that's it. But again, they are an actual they are an archer unit. So there is that. We'll see how they will actually dwell against us in this distance combat. Again, I do have a priest, so he's gonna heal nicely. Us if need be. Okay, move on. Go over here with my beautiful Riders of Rohan. Turn towards those hatchlings. Yeah, they will be able to attack us. That's okay. Completely okay. By my standards. Oh, I will be able to jump even here with someone like these priests right here. Yeah, they won't be able to be... well, they actually will be able to attack them, as they are also ranged, right? Draconian, they have the range capabilities. They have the range capabilities in these. You can see this is exactly like that's the beyond the minimum range. That is the max range. So they will have a penalty of 75, right? 75 without line of sight, but it's a line of sight penalty. So we hide behind the rock. That will give us kind of an advantage. I want to keep like these guys alive, but it's question if they're gonna go for them or they're gonna go for our halberdiers or the archers. That is truly the question. We still hell's bells. I'm gonna go in and risk this. Move in with our priest so they can support our cav there. Is that all we have to do? Okay, let's end again and see, because I want to lure them. I want to lure them. I want to see how they dwell against us. Okay, they're actually going for something else. Oh, they're going, of course, for the king. Okay, that's nice. They won't be able to, of course. That's a melee unit. So they did a nice damage against King Conan, which is never a good thing. Let's immediately heal King Conan. Ironheart, thank you very much. Now they can attack once. That's not three time attack, I think, at least. Let's see. Yeah. Yeah, can't trigger up at three this one. So their attack won't be able to be triggered by three times. Okay, 7-8. I'm going for the flamers from the sides, and that's a flanking and a charge. This one, 18 to 28, will be able to, even if we get a crit on these bastards, it will be perfect. It would be really, really perfect if we get a critical. So let's first get rid of these bastards, maybe ranged penalty, or just a spirit ray on these fuckers. Yeah, flanking, plus flanking. Yes. Yes, additional. Yes, touch me harder. Thank you very much. So those are a little bit hatching. That fire that these bastards did, like a AoE, and did they also damage on our priests, which is never a good thing from these draconian flamers. They like flamers like that. Oh, projectile resistant flanking. I want to finish off these bastards first because of Conan, and we get an actual critical hit. There you go, and a level up for them. Always a nice thing indeed. Always a nice thing indeed. So now they are open their flanks to the damnable draconian crusher. So we have to deal with the halberdier or something there. But I will definitely see what to do here. I was thinking of dropping additional bless on these bastards, but bless is not gonna give the damage, right? It's just a defense thing. Yeah, defense against the dark arts. So in general, I won't be able to do much except what I have that, finish them off immediately. But I'm hoping for that crit. But again, if we do, we have to see how happy Faye. So the happier he is morale-wise, he might do a crit and outright kill the bastards. That would be much more preferable, to be honest. But because this is an archer unit, yes, it does. You see, this lacks strong defensive abilities. They possess very powerful range attack. As a result, archers are most effective, of course, when they. But again, because they are dead, they are kind of more susceptible to the attack of the cav and all the others. So let's do it immediately like this, without dropping the blast. Excellent, and did not kill off right immediately. Okay, so now I'm hoping melee. Okay, I'm hoping that a beautiful, beautiful, sexy cat will survive this encounter. And specifically, I want to see what I can do with Conan the Barbarian here. That is Conan the King, the Lion. Let's see. Yeah, well, I can definitely project 5 to 8, and that's not a huge chunk considering the healthy 46. 5 to 7, and probably even fucking them in the ass hard with the. With poison, but I think this guy actually might even have poison. No, fire protection. No, they do not have poison protection. 15 to 23 with a charge and into their flanks. I mean, he's a warlord. Why drop that? I mean, and then finish them off with the beautiful halberdiers. But that's only one for them. See. They also, because they have the overwhelm ability, they will be very much pressed upon fucking them in the ass. That is our halberdiers, because of the overwhelm ability. Remember that they're gonna defend once, right? Because we attack them once, they're gonna defend once. So that's 10 to 16 damage. If we attack them from this side and attack them from back, our halberdiers will be able to do a flanking maneuver and fuck them in the ass. So Conan, let's go completely to behind, like right behind, so they can turn towards you. Let's go, Conan. And attack them immediately here. Okay, that's okay, beautiful. Now onto this. And hope for the best. Because honestly, I just can hope for the best. Not from that flank. I want a flanking maneuver. Go out here behind completely. No, we don't get the flanking maneuver. Oh, I am kind of disappointed there. That actually might be a bad thing, because they're in defense. See the shield? That's gonna be a bad mojo. We'll end the turn and see how this is gonna go for us. Okay, that could have gone worse. That actually could have gone worse. Like it could trigger three times like that. Oh, like he could have died. Conan at this point, he could have died like a little bitch. Conan, finish it off. Finish it off. First, I want someone to heal Conan. Someone heal Conan! If he dies, everybody dies. Honestly, then you have to like three turns and you have a massive negative morale on your... And you cannot research and all the good stuff. Fuck off. Excellent. Plus, maybe he gains a level finally at some point. Well, not now, but he will gain a level. We'll be told when he gains a level. So there you go. At least we gain a trooper rank on our archers, which is not bad at all. 44, and now this thing is under our control. We have two additional gold mines, and we get plus 38, and that's sexy, like a beast. Plus minus, we get plus 38 and minus 38 and upkeep. Ridiculous, of course. Ridiculous. So yeah, anywho, I'm gonna end it here, my friends, and next time, more love, more drunks, more women, more draconian women, and more expansion. Indeed. All best to you, my friends.